And the final item of business this evening is a member's business debate on motion 7514 in the name of Michael Mara on final report of the Independent Oversight and Assurance Group on Tayside's mental health services. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. As ever, I invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I invite Mr Mara to open the debate for around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to members for the opportunity to bring this important issue to the Chamber. My thanks also to the Independent Oversight and Assurance Group appointed by Scottish Ministers for the report we're here to discuss. Thanks also to the Stakeholder Participation Group for their work over the past few years and for finding the time to meet me in advance of the debate. In the last 5 years, 345 people in Tayside have lost their lives to suicide. 158 of those in my home city of Dundee. 345 lives lost, 345 families thrown into turmoil and grief. Families who needed better of their services, their government and all of us. These deaths speak to a mental health service in crisis. And for every soul lost, dozens more were hanging on by their fingernails. It's in the context of that crisis that an independent inquiry into mental health services in Tayside, led by Dr. David Strang, was launched. It reported in early 2020, Presiding Officer, with 49 separate recommendations for Tayside and 2 for the Scottish Government. Dr. Strang went on to publish a progress report in 2021 that, damningly, found there remained a long way to go to deliver the improvements that are required, and very significantly noted concerns about the level of confidence in the accuracy of the reported progress. I will return to this later. Now we have yet another report in front of us from another group of experts. They have again noted some improvements and again identified the urgent work still needing done. The pace of change is far too slow. All urgency is missing. I raised the delayed discharge of my constituent Ryan Caswell with the First Minister 8 months ago here in the Chamber of the Parliament. The First Minister called his situation unacceptable. There has been no change. Ryan has been living in Carsview Hospital for 3 years. Ryan has complex care needs, autism spectrum disorder and learning disabilities. In 3 years, his desperate parents have been unable to find suitable accommodation or care packages. So for 3 years, he's been forced to stay in a hospital that is completely inappropriate for his needs. And for 3 years, his parents have worried day and night about his care, his safety and his future. There are dozens of people in Tayside waiting for the board, this government and this minister to get their acts together and deliver the care they need, the care we all promise. I would like to hear from the Minister in his remarks a commitment and a plan for ending the scandal of delayed discharge in our mental hospitals that is identified in this report. But of course, services cannot just be wished into existence. They have to be planned, managed and resourced appropriately. Analysis provided to me by the Royal College of Psychiatrists shows that Tayside has the highest rate of consultant psychiatrist vacancies in Scotland. Less than half of posts are filled. In one service, only 1 in 5 of those posts are filled. 80% unfilled. Some of this huge weight is picked up by hugely expensive locum staff. These staff do not fill out-of-hours shifts. They do not provide staff development, and they play no part in the planning for any future robust services in our communities. For years, we heard from service users that people with a dual diagnosis of mental health and substance use struggled to access services. The Dundee Poverty Commission's interviews with hundreds of citizens in Dundee, the Dundee Drugs Commission, the authorities denied them all until the evidence became overwhelming, and this was a feature of Dr. Strang's reports. At that point, they promised to do better. So where are we now? The Oversight Group reports that dual diagnosis will be addressed at a later date. The Strang report wasn't delivered 3 weeks ago, Presiding Officer. It was delivered 2 years ago. After all of those previous years of denial, we'll get to it when we get to it is nowhere near good enough. Delayed discharge, workforce planning, dual diagnosis. Just a few of the urgent challenges the service faces identified in this report to ministers and to which we require a full response. I want to close, Presiding Officer, with what I know must be a central question for this minister. NHS Tayside has had to be dragged kicking and screaming to the reform process. And of huge concern, this report shows that serious doubts remain about their commitment to it. After Dr Strang's Progress second report called into question the accuracy of the reported progress from local leadership, the Oversight Group reported in January last year. Tayside had 28 recommendations rated as green and 21 as amber. Our independent assessment had 9 recommendations rated as green, 38 as amber, and 2 as amber red. Worlds apart, quite literally incredible. Can this Tayside board really be trusted to mark its own homework? The evidence says no. Can this Tayside board be left alone to deliver the change we need? The City of Dundee says no. I hope the Minister will set out tonight his plans for the future of governance. The Minister clearly believed that additional oversight was required, or he would not have appointed this external group. The Oversight Group does not believe it should become permanent, but previous measures have proven to be insufficient, entirely insufficient. So to whom will NHS Tayside be accountable? Who will hear their reports? Who will ensure the echoes of the lost are heard, the silence of the helpless known, and the cries of the bereaved answered? If we are back here in 3 years with another report and another set of recommendations, that will have been an abject failure that shames us all, and it will be measured out in many more lost lives.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Marner. We move to the open debate. I call first Graeme Day, to be followed by Paul Sweeney. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Day.
Thank you, President Officer. I want to begin with a few thank yous. Firstly, to Michael Marner for bringing this incredibly important topic forward for debate. And secondly, to the Minister for setting up the Independent Oversight and Assurance Group. Because without that intervention, I seriously question whether we'd have seen any meaningful progress made in addressing the state of mental health services provided by NHS Tayside. But with due respect to Mr Marner and Mr Stewart, however, the biggest thank you must go to the Independent Oversight and Assurance Group for the job they have done. I had the privilege of meeting with Fiona Lees and her team during their work, and I don't mind admitting I was hugely impressed, not only by their commitment and their approach, but more importantly, their candour. They answered every question I put to them in a way which left me reassured that these were people who intended to leave Tayside's mental health services in far better shape than they found them, and they weren't going to be fobbed off or kidded by cosmetic improvements. And that's why, like others, I have every confidence in what their final report says, good and bad, is credible. Presiding Officer, I must admit, initially I was a little conflicted about how I viewed the picture the report paints. I wanted to take heart from the progress highlighted. But the more I reflected on it, the more I came back to this. As Michael Marner has alluded to, the Oversight Group operated for a year. Prior to that, NHS Tayside had ample opportunity to drive the progress demanded by Professor Strang, first of all in his initial report, and then the follow-up report, the progress report in June 2021. So when I look at areas still requiring attention, I can't help but feel deeply disquieted that we are not far further forward. And you do wonder what it will take for NHS Tayside to get its house in order. The report notes, for example, and I quote, some important areas relating to workforce still have a long way to go. There is also an urgent need to improve some aspects of governance and public performance reporting as a means of developing a more open and transparent culture and building trust among the communities of Tayside. Presiding Officer, why on earth are the group still having to highlight a need for those at the top to properly support and lead a highly skilled and committed staff to ensure they can do their jobs properly, not to mention involving them in major decisions of service delivery? And why hasn't transparency and rebuilding trust and confidence within that wider community already been placed at the heart of everything the board does around mental health? Is it any wonder that NHS Tayside has the worst record for recruiting general adult psychiatry consultants in Scotland? When these skilled individuals are in such demand, why would they choose to work for a board whose reputation in the field is as NHS Tayside's it is? Yes, progress has been made, but there remains much more to do to improve the mental health offering and rebuild trust, and in so doing, hopefully make recruitment earlier. For me, Presiding Officer, there are two very obvious questions as we look to the future. Firstly, how confident can we be that the momentum for change will be maintained? Secondly, how will progress or lack of progress be monitored from here on in? How will NHS Tayside's feet be held to the fire? As the MSP for Angus South, I have confidence about the intent and the direction of travel around community mental health service provision in that part of Tayside. I've engaged directly with the Angus Health and Social Care Partnership on that and been able to make some suggestions to ensure all cohorts are captured. I believe they're on the right track. I wouldn't expect anything else, to be honest, under the leadership of Gail Smith. But the Angus situation is inextricably linked to that of wider Tayside. We need, for example, a decision about single site provision. I understand that the lease on Castview is up in around 18 months' time, and the physical environment at Strathmartin has been raised as a source of concern for patients and staff. So, having praised the Minister for the action he took in setting up the group in October 2021, I also look to him in closing to hopefully provide assurance that there will be no backsliding in Tayside now the Oversight Group has produced its final report, and that we will emerge from the mess that he, following on from initial work set and trained by G. Freeman, has set about sorting, with mental health services provided by NHS Tayside that properly and fully meet the needs of those who require them. Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bay. I now call Paul Sweeney to be followed by Tess White. Up to 4 minutes, Mr. Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I want to thank my friend, Mr. Mara, the Member for North East Scotland, for tabling this motion for debate, this vital motion for debate in the Chamber, and I was happy to support it. 3 years ago, Dr. David Strang set out a list of 49 recommendations for NHS Tayside and two for the Scottish Government as a whole, a clear list of remedies to solve Scotland's mental health crisis. Yet, as we debate this important motion this evening, 3 years down the line, well over half of those 49 recommendations for the Health Board are marked by failure, a worrying sign of the lack of urgency and complacency that defines Scotland's mental health crisis. In the 2 years following Strang's report, there were 144 probable suicides in the Tayside area. And when reading this report and listening to the contributions of colleagues this evening, harrowing as they have been in some cases, it is all too easy to find oneself lost in the numbers and statistics. But it is crucial to remember that behind those figures were 144 lives lost to suicide in Tayside. I must question, had more urgency been shown in enacting the recommendations, how many of those vulnerable lives would still be here with us today, still with their families and friends, and still a part of their communities? The Tayside Mental Health Report paints a disturbing image of how we are willing to treat our most vulnerable. However, the problems facing NHS Tayside do not exist in a vacuum. I ask colleagues here today, can you confidently say that mental health patients in your constituencies receive the treatment that they deserve? The mental health crisis which threatens Dundee and its hinterland is prevalent in many post-industrial Scottish cities. Stark comparisons can be made between the experiences of Glaswegians and Dundonians over the years. Both Dundee and Glasgow City have stubbornly high suicide mortality rates which stand well above the Scottish average. These higher than average suicide rates in our cities can be put into context by some of the cruel ways inequality impacts health and social outcomes in Scotland. Indeed, the national records of Scotland highlight that the rate of suicide in the most deprived areas of Scotland was almost three times higher than in the least deprived. This relationship between poverty and poor mental health is the ultimate reminder of how hard life can be for those who find themselves at the bottom of our social hierarchy, the ultimate reminder of how unfair our system can be. And against this backdrop, it is deeply disappointing that funding for mental health services in the next financial year will be frozen despite the health budget increasing overall by 6.2%, failing the Scottish Government's own aspiration to have mental health expenditure as a 10% share of the entire National Health Service budget. Deeply disappointing. And whilst this is a difficult topic to discuss, the general trend in Scotland can, in some cases, allow for optimism. In 2021, the number of people dying from suicide fell to its lowest level since 2017. Partly driven by an improvement in outcomes for female mental health patients. A noticeable decrease in suicide rates for any group in our country should be acknowledged. However, it is imperative that that we can remain cognisant of the disproportionate impact of suicide amongst young men. Just last week, I spoke in this chamber about the effects that the cost of living crisis is having on young men's mental health. The Samaritans report that they have seen their call lines skyrocket, with more and more people mentioning finance and unemployment concerns as a stressor. The Tayside Mental Health Report shows clearly that we cannot become complacent. Despite a recent decrease in suicide numbers overall, the mental health crisis is far from solved in Scotland. We know the effects that poverty has on mental health and suicide rates, with the cost of living crisis driving more Scots into poverty and making life more and more difficult each day. As I stand here, Scotland faces a growing crisis, a mental health crisis that is currently being compounded by our failing economy. We must act now. We must ensure that these recommendations are seen as essential, not optional. We must ensure that adequate resource is dedicated to implementing them. It's only by putting words into action that we can protect our most vulnerable in Tayside and across Scotland.
Thank you very much, Mr Sweeney. I now call Tess White to be followed by Richard Leonard. Up to 4 minutes, Ms White.
Deputy Presiding Officer, I too thank Michael Mara for securing the time for this evening's debate, and so quickly after it was postponed a couple of weeks ago. After the findings of David Strang's 2020 Trust and Respect report into mental health services in Tayside, it's vital that parliamentarians continue to shine a light on the provision of these services after grave concerns were raised in the Scottish Parliament in 2018. And I am encouraged today to hear Graham Day's passion for change. I was not an MSP in 2018, but I knew of the public campaign for an inquiry into Tayside's mental health services. I read about the tragic story of David Ramsey, who hung himself after a second emergency assessment at Carsview. I was horrified by the increase in suicides in Dundee by 61%. My own family has experienced the devastating impact of suicide. My heart goes out to all the families across Tayside who have lost loved ones this way. As a North East MSP, I've seen Carsview through the eyes of constituents, and I've felt their fear as they've tried to navigate a frightening system that was so stacked against them. And so I looked at the final report of the Independent Oversight Group on Tayside's mental health services, not just with interest, but with personal and professional investment. Reading between the lines, there's a tremendous amount of work still to be done, and I particularly struggle to understand why Tayside executive partners and the IOAG continue to be apart in their assessment of progress. And as Michael Mara rightly pointed out, the report states that Tayside executive partners have reported 33 green recommendations and 16 amber. The IOAG have rated 20 green, 29 amber and 2 red. Deputy Presiding Officer, that's a gulf in assessment, not a gully. And how can that be? There are two areas in the latest report I find extremely concerning. The first is on workforce and the second is on culture. On workforce, as the report emphasises, there's still a long way to go. That seems an understatement when it was reported just a couple of weeks ago that Tayside is at the epicentre of a national scandal in adult psychiatric care, with serious issues recruiting consultant psychiatrists. And I hope the Minister will address this in closing. On culture, the report identifies an urgent need to improve governance and public performance reporting as a means of developing more open and transparent culture. It's something we've heard so many times and something that's been raised with me by my constituents time and time again. These are fundamental points that still require significant improvement. And the essence of David Strang's report was trust and respect. He said that the successful delivery of healthcare services depends on good levels of trust between healthcare providers and patients, their families and carers. That's the gold standard, but Tayside falls well short, well short. Deputy Presiding Officer, there's still a huge way to go for mental health services in Tayside. This may have been the IOAG's final report, but it's definitely not the end of the line. This process still needs oversight and accountability from Grant Archibald, and I'd like to say that, from Grant Archibald and his team to the highest levels of the Scottish Government. It can't be brushed under the carpet any longer. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms White. And I call the final speaker in the open debate, Richard Leonard, up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank Michael O'Mara for bringing this debate to Parliament? In so doing, he has performed a democratic service, not just for his own constituents, but for all of our constituents, because the way that families in Tayside have been let down by failed mental health services is not just a local scandal, it's a national scandal. And that's the reason why I pressed the First Minister to set up the Strang Review back in 2018, and that is why I pressed her as well to implement all of the recommendations in full when his report, Trust and Respect, was published 2 years later. But what has been a recurring failure here, and we see it once again with the report of this independent oversight and assurance group last month, is what David Strang described in 2021 as, I quote, an over-reporting of progress. So of his 51 recommendations, there are 33 where the oversight group agrees with the assessment of the Scottish Government and Tayside executive partners. But of the 18 recommendations where the independent review group disagrees with the government's assessment, in all bar one of them, they have found that the situation is much worse than the health board and the government claim. That there is at best optimism bias, at worst a culture of denial and an indifference to the truth. Listen to some of the language the authors of this report choose. Of the new mental health strategy in Tayside, Living Life Well, they call work streams unrealistic, that they are spread too thinly. They also say, and I quote, the governance structures for mental health also continue to be overly complex and unclear in terms of responsibility for what? On the treatment of patients. The report is highly critical of the three strikes and you're out approach regarding appointments, which results in closed case outcomes. Psychological therapy services still exist, as they say, in a somewhat confused landscape. There is a plethora of activity on stakeholder engagement, but much of this is fragmented, with no real sense of people working together on shared priorities. Advocacy organisations are still under-resourced, understaffed and under-financed. NHS staff feel, to quote the report, it's Groundhog Day with reviews upon reviews. And one of the most damning findings is that a report with the title Listen, yes, Listen, a survey of the views of people who use mental health services in Tayside, we learn, has not been listened to at all, with no formal consideration of the report by the Health Board and no formal response from Tayside executive partners. I will conclude with this. 2 days ago, I met up again with Mandy McLaren, whose 28-year-old son Dale tragically completed suicide 8 years ago. Mandy is one of the most courageous women I've ever met. When we spoke, the first thing she said was, "Where's the action? We've had enough bad reports on bad reports." She told me that as recently as last week, someone in crisis had to phone Wedderburn House 67 times to get through. She knows of others who have had a 3-year wait for a psychologist and are still waiting. Mandy McLaren's message is simple. Enough is enough. It's time that this government was part of the solution instead of being part of the problem. Because I tell the minister, the government is on the wrong side of this argument with the people. The government is on the wrong side of this argument over a health service, including a mental health service, which is supposed to be freely available at the point of need.
The government is on the wrong side. And this is not just about governmental duty, it's a moral and a social duty. It's time to end this shameful betrayal of a community in need, to act, to plan, to show respect, and to finally bring hope in place of despair.
Thank you, Mr. Leonard. I now invite the Minister to respond to the debate for around 7 minutes, Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to thank members for their contributions tonight and for Mr. Mara for bringing this debate to the Chamber. And I'll do my best to respond to as many of the points raised as I possibly can in the short time that we have. First of all, I'd like to put on record again my appreciation of the Oversight Group's work and the inclusive approach they have taken throughout their tenure. So my thanks to Fiona Lees, Fraser McKinley and David Williams for all that they have done. And the reason why I appointed this oversight group was, to use the words of Michael Mara, I didn't want folk marking their own homework. And that is why they went in. They have had a huge amount of engagement with frontline staff. That has been commendable. And I'm conscious that those conversations often painted a difficult picture. But they are views which must be heard. And they're also views that I've heard when I've been out and about in Tayside, of which I've been probably in Tayside's mental health services more than any other mental health services in the country, because I want to ensure that we get it right for the families that have been spoken about here today. Importantly, the Oversight Group have also listened to the voices of lived experience of mental health and learning disability services in Tayside. And we must also listen to what their experiences tell us. And I have to say that one of the most frustrating things for me is that people that I have talked to feel that they have not been listened to at the right time. And that is wrong. And I know from this job that those services that are performing best in the country at this moment are the services where people are being listened to and people are helping shape the services. And that should be the same in Tayside. In implementing the recommendations from the Oversight Group, we must ensure that individuals and their families are empowered to make meaningful contributions which shape the future of services in Tayside. And I also want to recognise that there are a wealth of organisations across Tayside who are doing fantastic work to promote mental health and wellbeing across the region. And I'm pleased that the Oversight Group was able to meet with many of them. And I accompanied Fiona to a mental health festival in Perth, which was extremely well attended. And I have to say, again, that many of the stories that I heard from folks who attended that were extremely frustrating. These people must be listened to, without doubt. I welcome all of the contributions to the Oversight Group's final report. The report is comprehensive and it clearly articulates how we move forward and where we must now focus all of our efforts. And I'm encouraged to see the progress that has been made so far in some respects, in terms of strategic planning, clarity on roles and responsibilities and accountabilities in delivering services and in patient safety, including the approach to significant adverse event reviews, distress brief intervention and the introduction of a new observation protocol. However, as has been highlighted during this debate, there is clearly much work to be done across many of the original trust and respect recommendations and the six key areas for priority action that were highlighted by the Oversight Group in their final report. I have therefore been seeking assurance that the necessary outstanding actions will be taken. I've met with the Tayside Executive Partners and Chief Officers to set out my clear expectations on the importance of their role in delivering the improvements that are required. They have committed to producing an improvement plan by the end of March, which will set out clear actions and milestones that deliver on these key priority areas. And I can assure the Chamber that that improvement plan will be gone through with a fine tooth comb to make sure that what needs to be done will be done. And I will continue to meet with Tayside executive partners to review progress, and my officials will provide an ongoing package of support to colleagues across Tayside as they develop and then implement that improvement plan. In tandem, we'll work together to agree the criteria to de-escalate the health board from its current level 3 escalation in respect of mental health services on the board performance escalation framework. But that will not happen until there is real improvement. And this will, I'll give way to Mr. Mara, of course.
Michael Mara.
I greatly appreciate it, Minister, and also through the Chair, Presiding Officer. An improvement plan is right that we have, but to whom will it be held accountable? Will the plan be published? And who will have the opportunity to question those lead partners beyond yourself, Minister, in terms of a public forum so people can be held to account for the delivery of the points that will be set out in it?
Minister.
Well, they will be accountable to me because I will be looking at this very closely indeed. I will not be putting in another oversight group or anything like that. Now is the time for action. We stop them from marking their own homework. We have seen that, as some have said, they have over-promised in what they have delivered. In some cases, it could be said that some things have been a tick-box exercise. That's not good enough. That cannot be. So they will report to me. And what I will say to every member in this chamber, and members of who represent Tayside have already written to, I'm more than happy to keep folk absolutely appraised of what is going on there, and I'm more than happy to share all of the information that I receive and all of this as we move forward, because there has to be openness and transparency here. We owe that to the people that you, Mr. Mara, Mr. Leonard and others have talked about today. We owe that to them. Additional scrutiny in this respect and on the improvement plan will be provided via the Scottish Government's National Planning and Performance Oversight Group. In the coming weeks, I will also meet with the Chair of the Board at NHS Tayside, the Chairs and Vice-Chairs of the 3 Integration Joint Boards, and members of the Lived Experience Stakeholder Participation Group. These meetings will serve to further reflect on the conclusions that the Oversight Group have reached in that final report. And I will also set out my very clear expectation that the Chair's role in scrutinising and supporting the improvement plan will be vital to ensuring we make improvements for the people of Tayside who rely on these mental health and learning disability services. Before I conclude, Presiding Officer, I would particularly like to thank members of the Stakeholder Participation Group for their tireless work in recent years in extremely difficult circumstances. I know that none of this has been easy for them, and we owe it to them to get this right, because members of the group have shown bravery and openness in sharing their experiences. I therefore want to take this opportunity to say that we are listening, and will continue to work with you to ensure the improvements required in Tayside are delivered. Presiding Officer, there is a clear and collective interest here, so I welcome having the chance today to debate these important issues, and I am very clear in my commitment to make sure that the findings of this report are implemented, and I want to continue these conversations and work right across the Chamber over the coming weeks and months to support the delivery of the high-quality mental health and learning disability services that the communities and people of Tayside deserve. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.